Welcome to the Rialto Marketing Podcast. Today's episode is a revenue acceleration series interview where we talk to seven-figure B2B service firm owners that are actively trying to grow their business and get to the next level. We talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly so that you can learn from their experience. Hi, I am Tim Fitzpatrick with Rialto Marketing, where we believe you must remove your revenue roadblocks if you want to accelerate growth, and marketing shouldn't be difficult. Thank you so much for taking the time to tune in. I am super excited to have Amanda LaChapelle with me from Before Networks. Amanda, welcome. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me, Tim.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm excited to dig into this with you today. Before we do that, I want to ask you just a few rapid-fire questions if you're ready to jump in.
Sure.
Okay. So very quickly, what do you do? How long have you been doing it?
I'm the chief operating officer for Before Networks. We're an MSP located in Font Hill, Ontario, Canada, in case people don't know that part of the geography well. And my day-to-day is, it changes literally from day to day. Operations is kind of that kind of beast. But anything I can do to help support people to deliver the best service that we can for our clients.
What's the most important lesson you've learned in running the business?
There's so many that it's really difficult to be like, this is the most important. I think the idea of just being able to not be self-critical in the sense of being down on yourself, but being able to analyze the things that you do and not be so attached to the outcome that you're not willing to be able to make changes, or even if they're micro changes, to be able to better yourself on an ongoing basis. That's something that can be really hard for some people to work on, and something that I notice when people are able to adapt and take that kind of mentality on, that they end up bettering themselves in ways that maybe they didn't anticipate.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. You know what I started doing? And I think there's so many different ways we can use this, but if we're open to the feedback, I think a lot of times it's hard for some people to hear feedback from other people. I've started using it in ChatGPT. So, you know, taking sales conversations or meetings that I've had, dump the transcript in and ask for feedback. Like, what did I do well? Where can I improve? And because the AI is unemotional, right? And so hearing that from something that's not another being, I don't know, maybe for some people it softens the blow.
Well, if you get mad at it, then you're only going to be really mad at the robot overlord, whatever in the sky that's going to control
everything
day, right?
Yeah, exactly.
That was sarcasm, just to be clear.
Yeah. It's actually pretty darn good feedback. It's really interesting. So if people that are watching or listening have not tried that, give it a shot and see what you think. Cause it's, I found it helpful, but, we all know growing a business is hard. Do you have any kind of mantra or motivational saying you say to yourself or share with your team to help push through those times of challenge or hurdles?
Well, I think we kind of pick different themes for the, like, each year. And mine for this year is really just do it scared. I talk with the team all the time about the things that I'm trying to take on that might be scary for me or outside of my comfort zone or putting myself out there, and I encourage them to do the same. And so does Brian. So it's kind of part of the DNA in terms of Before Networks is trying things and seeing what happens. Not everybody is bold and brave by the measure of the world, but they're for themselves against where they were, you know, yesterday or the day before that. You know, that's what we kind of ask people to do.
Yeah. I love that one. I recently read a book, and honestly, I can't remember the name of it because I didn't finish all of it. But one of the things that he talked about in there that really did resonate was always operating in this place of fear, because if you're in that zone, you're pushing your comfort zone and your limits, and that's where we grow. And so, I love that. So you kind of mentioned that you run the business with your husband, Brian. Can you share some of the learning lessons about running a business with your other half?
It's not for the faint of heart.
Yeah.
it's really important to have some boundaries. And please, I would just like to say at the onset of this, this is not me saying this, like, we got it down, we're doing great. These are the things that we, you know, we have to focus on an ongoing basis and make sure we keep trying for alignment on, because it isn't easy. We have to leave the things at work and try not to be discussing them too much at home, because there should be, you know, clear spaces. And I think the part that works well is that I'm in operations and he's in sales and finance. So though they obviously interact and operate with each other, but having two distinct roles and two distinct impacts in the company allows us to have the freedom to kind of manage our end of things and then come to each other for feedback. And I find that distinction very helpful.
Yeah. So you guys both have your domains.
Correct.
And that helps keep things separated yes, to a certain extent. Yeah. I would also imagine that, like you said, having clear boundaries, but then just communicating, having super open lines of communication is helpful.
Open lines of communication, though, are something you have to be really careful about. Like, you have to remember that the walls that exist between yourself and another employee do not exist between husband and wife. Yeah. So if you're going to have that open communication, you need to set aside separate time during the workday to be able to do that, so that you're not having that open communication in front of all of your staff, because that's probably a boundary that shouldn't be crossed in terms of, you can talk about planning and whatever, but when you hit something where you may not agree, or where, you know, there's some conflict to work through, that should be done away from everybody else.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. Cause I know it's, I worked with my dad for over 10 years and, it was a fantastic experience for me. It's not always that way for others, but, I also realized that, like, I wasn't working with the spouse, which I think adds another layer of complexity to that. Thank you for that. One of the things that we talked about when we connected before the interview was you had talked about MSP GeekCon in 2023 and that being a really big moment for you. Can you just share with us what happened at that event and you know, what changed things for you?
Well, I think to understand the importance of that event, I just got to rewind very quickly.
Cool. Yeah.
Because the beginning of the company, I mean, it's mine and Brian's company, but he was the one working in it day to day. I had another company. And so when I decided to close that company down and work at B4 Networks full time, I was coming into a world that he had very much shaped. I had given my input. I had been involved, but from the sidelines. And finding my feet was a bit interesting. Again, while trying to respect these boundaries that we were talking about before in the husband and wife relationship. So a lot of my experience inside of the IT world or service delivery comes from actually working in call centers before, working in other places, like I worked for Dell Canada, and understanding, you know, what that looks like from that end, but not the actual technical side of things. So when I went to MSP Geek, I was bringing two of our technicians, and the mantra that was put out there about the conference, it was the first time a conference had happened, was, you know, bringing your level one technicians up to level threes or bettering your technicians. And I was like, okay, I'd like to bring these technicians to go, but I'm also interested in, you know, what this is all about. I'm going to go too, so that I can, you know, learn. I'm the one who's, you know, built out our LMS and things internally in terms of training people. I want to understand a little bit better myself. And some of the tracks and stuff that they were talking about kind of spoke to that. That's what I went in thinking I was getting and definitely got that. But what I got even more than that were these amazing conversations with other business owners, other technicians, just this community of people that were like, hey, this is how I do the things that I do. Here's kind of my recipe book. Let's talk about it. What do you think about this? Or, you know, if I was you, this is what I would do. And instead of, you know, before was channeling everything through this relationship with my husband, I now had this wider community that I could talk to. And, you know, I knew that there was a Discord or whatever before, but I hadn't really engaged and I didn't like join it or anything like that. I went into it kind of going, oh, these are the people in the, you know, that I know in the community, which was like two people, and I'm going to go and see what it's about. And I walked away with friends. I walked away with connections and a better understanding. And I decided to kind of engage in the community, double down, if you will. And I have been so blessed by all of the opportunities that have come from kind of giving into that community. They've given back to me, and I didn't ask for it, but I certainly appreciate it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, well, when you connect with other similar business owners, we all got the same issues, right?
Yeah.
MSPs run into the same types of problems. And sometimes you can help somebody solve a problem you've already solved. And sometimes it's the exact reverse. And it gives you the opportunity to connect with people that are ahead of you from a company gestation and growth process, and people that are before you. And I think there's always things to be learned from experiences like that. So,
and I think too, not being a non-technical person in this space, being connected with so many technical people that just really wanted to talk tech, was like, I'm willing to learn and listen. You can talk to me about this stuff. I don't always know what you're saying, but I'm happy to take in 50% of it. And then the next time that I hear it more is gonna stick. And like, you know what I mean? Like for me, besides, I also have to just preface, I'm extremely weird. And I have a bit of an interesting personality. So the goose people, they just spoke to me. Everybody there is a little bit silly themselves. So
yeah,
it was not hard to feel like I belonged there.
Yeah, cool. So I know you guys have had some recent, employee attrition. How'd you navigate this, and what did you learn from it? I mean, a lot of people face this, so.
Well, I think attrition, like, I almost hate that word because it always implies that, a person left you, right? Yeah. And I think the reality of the IT landscape is that people leave by quitting, but people leave by also stop bringing their best selves to work.
Yeah.
And sometimes that means that you as the owner have to make a decision in order to, you know, exit them into something else that's going to be better for them. Not to sound like George Clooney and Up in the Air or whatever, but but honestly, you know, at this point, they're obviously not able to admit to themselves that this is not for them anymore. This industry is incredibly stressful, and it's really important to take care of your employees. That's like our number one thing that we try to do, is to make sure that we're checking in with their mental health. And, you know, I think the acknowledgement just has to be that if someone's not in a position anymore to be able to give what they need to give to the role, that has to be okay. And if you as a business can look at that and say, naturally, because this is a stressful job, there's only so long that we're going to be able to retain people, then you need to have a plan for how you're going to bring new people in, how you're going to train them, and how you're going to move them up the ranks, because you can't look at it like a bad thing. It's actually something that's just part and parcel with this type of industry. And I also think it's a reflection of the people who do well in an MSP are going to be people who enjoy switching their hats and trying new things and need to be fed, right? But that can come at great personal cost. If the person can't manage their own mental health through that, that's going to take its toll. And you want to pay respect to that. I mean, some of my best people who've been with us for a very, very long time, we've all had hills and valleys. So when I say pay respect to that, I mean, give people some grace and some space when they're going through something to be able to navigate that and right themselves. And, you know, you'll have more luck of keeping them in the long run. I think there's also, you know, the conversation of what do we mean when we say take care of someone's mental health? Like, I think, you know, people always get kind of shy about that because they're like, well, I can't talk to someone. I'm not their therapist. That is not what I'm advocating for. What I'm saying is that, like, find out where the pain point is the same way as you would in marketing, and find out what it is that's stressing them out. So in our case here, for example, we had quite a few people that were stressed out by the idea of prioritizing. It would not matter that we would tell them that they have, you know, 30 tickets or whatever for the week. And that's actually quite normal. They just saw 30 tickets. And they wanted the pile to go down. And so having conversations about the pile's never going to go down, that's not our expectation. Our expectation is for, you know, the standard is this, I don't know, I'm going to make something up right here, is 5 tickets a day. The goal would be to get 10 done a day. Like, anything between that is fantastic. Teaching them how to prioritize in case that's not a skill set that they already have in their soft skills. These are the things that you can do to support your people in order to try and help them, you know, stay longer. And then if you can't do that, another thing that we've also been doing is working really heavily with automation and being, you know, like, how can we take the people that are working great, keep them interested through trying new things, but also, you know, doing this automation piece where, and I'm not just talking about an RMM, I'm talking beyond that, where we can really multiply the capacity of our current workforce and without having to necessarily always worry about hiring more people or keeping more of a headcount.
Yeah. Do you guys outsource any things or is everything done in-house?
No, everything's done in-house.
Okay. Yeah.
Actually, I guess accounting, but not the whole accounting, just part of it.
Yeah. I mean, because, you know, like I know there's, I mean, in the MSP space, especially, sometimes people will outsource help desk or outsource, you know, security operations or whatever it may be. There's a lot of opportunities to outsource certain things.
Oh, I think there's some validity in how everybody gets to choose how they run their business. For us, we've made it kind of a core to try and keep as much as we can in-house so that we can really, I mean, I'm not saying that you can't in the outsource section, but our team is so collaborative and they work together so closely. Like when we went through COVID, everybody was, you know, forced to go work from home, and I would get phone calls and messages going, can I come back to the office? Like they genuinely missed being around each other. They missed being around their friends and being in office. So I feel like that would be really difficult for someone who was working, you know, outsourced to kind of mesh in with that.
Yeah.
So I guess it'd be a curiosity to see how we'd navigate it. It's not something that we were considering at the moment though.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's no right or wrong answer, right? I mean, it's just, there's benefits and downsides to both. It's just a matter of, hey, what do you want out of your business? And what's the best way to make that happen? So I know a lot of acquisition in the MSP space. And you guys acquired another MSP in early 2020.
A split between an MSP and a break fix shop. But yes, that was to let you finish your question. Sorry.
Well, no, I was just going to say, what did you learn from that? And what have you learned since? Cause I think, I don't know, acquiring, it can be a great way to grow. Mm-hmm. But if you've never done it before, there's a lot of potential blind spots, I should say.
Well, I think there's like different kinds of acquisitions too, right? So there's a strategic acquisition, and I'm not going to say that this wasn't a strategic acquisition, but there's also emotional acquisitions. And I think for us, it was a bit of an emotional acquisition. So the break fix/MSP shop that we acquired was actually the first place that my husband had worked when we moved back to this area. So for him, the owner had approached him and was like, you know, I'm looking to retire from running a business. It's been like 25 years. I want to make sure that the people that have worked with me for quite some time are taken care of and the clients are taken care of. I know you'd do that. I can't entice you to come back and work for me. So, I mean, are you interested? Right.
Yeah.
And that conversation, from the moment that conversation happened, there was still a year before anything really moved. And it's really important to understand that emotional piece, whether or not it is a strategic or an emotional acquisition, the person behind the business that you're buying is married to how it is married to the way that they see it going. They have all of their, you know, accomplishments and ego built into what they've built. Whether it's amazing or literally a pile of crap, they've still got their own personal whatever involved in it. And it's not an easy contemplation. So you have to be realistic about whether or not they're going to be able to stick around and watch you change it, because they may not agree with those changes, even if you believe they're for the better. Acquisition is a great way to grow, but these things that I'm pointing out to be cognizant of need to factor into your plan, because if your plan involves and you all the relationships in the company that you're trying to acquire live with this person, then you need to keep that person happy to keep them around a little bit longer. If you think that you can show them better service and it doesn't matter, then that's not an equation for you. I think another thing that we learned, and it was actually a business coach that told us about it, we hadn't really contemplated before, maybe that's just our naivete and going into it, was just about having like a line of credit. We've never had any kind of debt for the business before. We've never taken out any kind of loan or anything. Everything was done like self-funded. And the getting a line of credit was the first time that we had ever done anything like that. But the reason for doing that is because when you have the transition between, you know, that company, the person takes their, if you're doing an assets purchase, the person takes everything that's in there and they keep it for themselves. They hand you the rest of it. You have to deal with the payroll. You have to float all the service that's going to happen for that first couple months before you start getting checks in. And if your business originally couldn't handle that in terms of, like in our case, it was a 100% growth overnight, basically, then, you know, you have to be able to financially plan for that. So that was important. And a thing that, like I said, we hadn't considered before. And I think a lot of people need to consider how they're going to do that, because those expenses are important. I mean, the list of things to go through is probably 3 or 4 podcasts in itself. But
yeah, it's a lot.
That was probably the most, like the most learning lesson that was really, really good for us to have given as a piece of advice.
Do you plan on making other acquisitions?
It's always in the pipeline, but for us, we've very much identified that it has to be something where there's an incredible fit. Doing an emotional acquisition has basically let us know that anything else would have to be more strategic, because the upheaval that an acquisition causes, both on both sides, both internally at your current company and at the company that you're acquiring, is a lot to navigate. So you want to make sure that you're getting the most ROI out of it. I would say that we're very happy we did the acquisition. If I had to do it all over again, I would certainly do a few things differently. But I think that would probably be a harder stretch in this current stage, where super MSPs are coming in and buying all the MSPs that are operationally mature that we would be looking at. So we say we're not disinterested in it, but we're actually not like going out and hunting for it, because the competition on that is wild. But if you're listening to this and you're looking to exit and you have a smart business and don't want to sell to those people, I mean, I'm not going to not talk to you.
Yeah. I get it. What would you say is the top thing that comes to mind that you might do differently
in an acquisition?
Yeah. With the acquisition.
I think if we were going to, take on, and this was actually something that my husband and I disagreed on. And in this case, I went out and I was not right. And I don't have a problem admitting that. I think if we were going to take it on again, I would probably keep it, because there was an MSP and a break fix component, I probably would keep it as a separate brand before, like leave it under that brand and slowly identify which clients were a good fit, and then move those ones over first before marrying everything into our brand. Because anybody who didn't appreciate the MSP model and who were break fix were put off by us from the jump. So that makes it difficult to overcome that in the relationship, because they were not ready for that kind of contract.
Got it. So at the time, were you trying to transition those break fix to
not MSP? Right away, but okay. But I need to quantify this, and I'm going to try to do this very gently.
Oh yeah, it's okay.
The previous owner was the kindest man with the most gentle heart, and his staff were the kindest people and the most gentle people. And so I'll give you an example of what would happen. One would show up on site. Everybody loves them. They would do a great job, and they would go in and they would fix things, and they would go, you know what? I love those people so much. I'm going to write down 2 hours on the bill instead of the 4 that I was there. And then when the owner would get the bill, the owner would go, oh, you know, they're so great, and they come back to us all the time. I'm going to knock a little off the top, right? So, like, there's a lot of things like that when you then take over and then say, no, the time is the time.
Yeah.
That's friction, right? Like, it's very different. You have to consider all of the pieces of the culture that was built in that company in terms of, you know, what are the clients used to? Are they used to you doing things that you wouldn't normally do? And so creating that separation and distinction, like this company was so giving of themselves, they would go and install a television, right? Like if you wanted them to, well, here's the problem. They would also go pick it up at Costco. And so the time to go pick up the television and install it was not billed. And it was just like a little markup on the television, but that's actually losing money. And as a company that operates by the numbers, that's not, that's not in line with how we would do things. And again, I don't want to say that's bad what they did, because it certainly earned them the goodwill with their customers, but it is a difference that the customers could feel. So yeah, it is an important thing to understand, because it creates friction, and friction can obviously have its own reasons for people leaving.
Yeah. Yeah. I know things are evolving quickly, constantly in the MSP industry. Any emerging trends or technologies that you're really excited about?
I kind of said it before when I talked about automation, but robotic process automation for me is always going to be something incredibly attractive. I think tools that have open APIs, so that we can stop necessarily worrying about having to deal with one single overlord vendor. We can mix and match as we need. That's always desirable. I think that, and that's going to be something that you're going to see more and more people pushing for, because with all this mergers and acquisitions that keeps happening, you know, you'll leave one vendor because you're dissatisfied with the service, and all of a sudden they'll buy up the new thing that you go into. So having that flexibility, you know, is kind of important. And I think when I talk about automation, I think most people would expect me to say AI, but most of AI is some that it's in its implication is a form of automation. I think we're going to see a lot between those two things that I just mentioned that's going to change the game. I don't know if you care if I mention vendors, but we're working with care. Yeah, so we switched to Halo in February, and was probably one of the best business decisions we've made in a very long time. Their single focus on bettering their product has been amazing. And for me, what I appreciate is that, like, things that I used to have in my documentation system, I am now slowly moving into how our PSA works, because the customization and configurability is so phenomenal that I can do what I want with it. And to have a product that has that kind of flexibility, I think you're going to see more MSPs want to have that kind of flexibility, because we are, you know, the stop. We are the things that the person, I would say, that is in between what is likely going to be regulation and the business community. And we need to have that kind of control in order to feel comfortable to guarantee. And where I'll give you an example of this is the incident response, right? If I, as an owner, am going to be held responsible for how we handle any kind of security breach or incident, I want to make sure that my staff do it the same way every single time. But human error is human error. Yeah. If I can configure my PSA to be able to handle it and walk somebody through the steps and create that accountability in how it works, for how we say it works, not how some over whatever body says it works, yeah, then that's attractive to me. That's always going to be good. It's going to help me guarantee longevity in ways that I don't know that everybody's considered.
Yeah. Where do you see the business in the next 5-10 years?
That automation piece is going to be huge. It's going to be huge in many. I'm trying not to tip my hand too much, but I'm going to say that we've got a lot of things in the works when it comes surrounding automation. And I think some of the best MSPs are understanding that the days of patch management and, you know, the simple things that we can do being a differentiator we're not in that time anymore. The things that we can do for our clients have to go above and beyond that. If you want to call yourself a person's IT partner and really position yourself to work with them strategically on how you grow their business, you can't be just talking about replacing the life cycle of their computers. You have to be talking about more.
Yeah. How are you staying on top of this stuff?
You know, what's crazy is that sometimes people ask me the question, like, how do you do your job if you go to so many conferences? And I'm like, I actually think it helps me do my job better. And the reason why I say that is because I will sit in, you know, any number of presentations. Some of them are sales driven by vendors, and some of them are not. There are other industry leaders that are giving me their insight. But then I also, you know, will sit in the bar and have conversations with other people and hear how they're doing it. And because of who I am and because of how I work, I can then come back, you know, throw that all up at my team and say, hey, this is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to tackle it. And then we come up with a plan and we go and we execute. And whether or not I'm there, I've got the ideas. I'm going out there and I'm getting these ideas and I'm putting my own twist on them and shaping them in the way that makes sense for our clients and for our business. And I wouldn't be able to do that if I wasn't exposed to that, right? Like, yeah. You can't stay in your bubble. You can't just live where you are and think that you're going to be innovative, because you're not going to be seeing anything that's out there. I think whether it be travel, whether it be, you know, learning, whatever it is, reading, you need to find ways to get outside of your everyday in order to expand your thinking, because without that, I mean, you can't conceptualize what's going to happen in the next 5 years. You can't think about anything beyond, how do I just do what I'm doing now to survive?
So for you, you're doing that at conferences and events.
Yeah. So I will attend conferences and events. And I, you know what else it's given me too, is really giving me a better relationship with the vendors that we work with. We've been able to ask for things that we need. Another great partner that we work with is Huntress. And we were talking about how it's really scary sometimes to think that you can have an incident happen and you have staff that's never walked through an incident before that you're going to have be involved in it. And they may not have used the product on a regular basis. So how do you teach them how to do that without like actually making an incident happen? Yeah. And one of our technicians actually had the conversation with somebody from Huntress at MSB Geek. And the next thing I know, they're in, we've got an entire like training facility set up in terms of, you can actually run an incident response
simulation
right from Huntress. Cool. And that was my tech that suggested that. Like, we wouldn't have that kind of access if I didn't have that kind of relationship, right?
Yeah.
So that's an important piece of, if we pay this money to these vendors every month, then it isn't just for the product, it's for also giving that feedback. They want to hear that from you the same way we want to hear from our clients, right?
Yeah. How often are you going to conferences?
I have been on a plane every month of this year so far, and only one of those was personal.
Okay.
Actually, no, except for 1 month.
Yeah. I was going to say, I know, especially in the MSP space, it seems like there's an event or a conference like every 3 or 4 days.
Well, you have to choose wisely. You have to think about who's going to be attending and what the focus is of the conference and who's speaking. You know, I like to look at the agenda ahead of time. And if it's just literally only, sponsors and vendors speaking, I need something more than that in order to attend the conference. And then I will look at who's attending and go, is there going to be people there from the communities that I operate in that we can connect and touch base on what's going on? And like have that kind of conversation. It's not that, you know, vendor tracks aren't great, but there should be more value than that if you're going to learn, right?
Yeah.
And if you're going to learn and you can't learn from the tracks of what's being talked to, you need to see if the attendees can teach you something.
Yeah, I love it. So, Amanda, knowing what you know now, anything you'd do differently?
In terms of the whole kit and caboodle?
Whatever you want to share.
I honestly think I would have probably dived into community a lot sooner. I think COVID was probably a detractor in that, and then the acquisition happening during that time. But I think I would have probably jumped into community a lot sooner. I think it can be really difficult, and I want to give my husband a lot of credit, because all my questions, and I have a lot of questions that I like to ask in the beginning, were always directed at him. You know, he was like my little Google for anything that I wanted to know. Had I had a community before that where I could have asked them, it might have taken some of that pressure off him, but it would have expanded those horizons probably a little bit sooner, because if you can't tell, I'm an extrovert and I like to socialize anyway. So
yeah.
I tend to do well in environments where I can learn from other people. So I would have probably doubled into that. Double clicked into that sooner.
Yeah, that's awesome. Amanda, I really appreciate your time. Where can people learn more about you?
Well, I post random videos on LinkedIn. I have a YouTube channel, which is not on the link here, but you can usually find a link to them in my LinkedIn posts. And then obviously, if you want to know anything more about B4 Networks, we have a pretty robust webpage, which you can find at b4networks.ca.
Cool. B4 Networks. Also,
Also, just want to say, if you're not a member of MSP Geek already, please join.
Yes, go join MSP Geek. We will make sure that all these links are in the show notes as well. So, Amanda, I really appreciate you taking the time. It's been a great conversation. And it's always interesting, especially for me, to interview people in the MSP space that haven't really come from the tech side of it. So I really do appreciate the your perspective on it. So thank you for that.
Thank you so much, Jim.
Yeah, absolutely. And those of you that are watching, listening, appreciate you as well. If you want to connect with us, you can do that over at rialtomarketing.com. The other resource we've got for you is over at revenueroadblockscorecard.com. We help clients remove revenue roadblocks in 9 key areas of marketing. If you want to know which of the 9 are slowing down your growth, that's where you can do it. So go check it out. Thank you again for the time, and till next time, take care.